This SciShow video is supported by Linode. You can get a $100 60-day credit on a new Linode account at linode.com/scishow. What's a surefire way to know that your rocket has reached the moon? Well, if it's 1916 and you're one of the founding fathers of modern rocketry, you might propose a bunch of magnesium flash powder, which would go off after your rocket crashed into it. But seriously, after some experiments, Robert Goddard concluded that it would take just 6.2 kilograms of magnesium flash powder to be, quote, strikingly visible. Unfortunately, a flash of light isn't much communication beyond, hey, we got here. But Goddard was onto something. A bunch of light is how we communicate through the vacuum of space, but scientists have spent over a century working out what kind of light works best. And one day, astronauts might even use lasers to phone home. At the turn of the 20th century, decades before most people thought it was even possible to launch stuff into space, scientists wondered how we could communicate with other worlds. They knew sound couldn't travel through a vacuum, and that outer space was very nearly a vacuum, so building a cosmic megaphone to shout at the universe was completely out of the question. The answer was electromagnetic radiation, aka light. After all, we've got a big ball of plasma in the sky reminding us that light can traverse the vacuum of space. But what you and I typically think of as light is just one tiny band in the middle of the electromagnetic spectrum. Over here, rocking the longest wavelengths and the lowest frequencies, you've got radio and microwaves. Hovering on either side of visible light is infrared and ultraviolet, and then you've got your X-rays and gamma rays over here with the shortest wavelengths and highest frequencies. And these are all light. Most are just invisible to us. And by the 1930s, everyone from scientists to broadcasters were using certain frequencies in the radio band of that spectrum to send messages around the world. They didn't need line of sight because the radio waves were bouncing off of a layer in the atmosphere called the heaviside layer. Today, we know it's a section of the ionosphere. But that means they couldn't be used for interplanetary communications because they wouldn't go through Earth's atmosphere. But luckily for scientists, they found a subset of radio waves that could make it into space, the ones with the highest frequencies. And while we haven't exchanged any radio messages with aliens, we do use those frequencies for all kinds of space communication, from keeping in contact with astronauts on the ISS to deep space spacecraft. Ever wonder how we get those amazing high-resolution images from the James Webb Space Telescope or send instructions to spacecraft like New Horizons on the other side of the solar system? It's all radio waves. But there's a problem. Radio waves are not very good in terms of how fast you can transmit data. The longer the wavelength of light, the less information you can transfer per second. And remember, the radio band has the longest wavelengths of the entire electromagnetic spectrum. So when New Horizons flew by Pluto in 2015, it took over 15 months to get all the data it collected back to Earth, at the painfully slow rate of 1 kilobit per second. We're communicating across billions of kilometers of near-empty space, but that feat still might not impress some people used to fiber optic cables and Cat6 Ethernet cables. And that's not the only disadvantage our radio signals have. They spread out as they go. The farther out a spacecraft is, the weaker its signal, and the harder it is to pick up its call home, or vice versa. Radio has served us well so far, but if humanity wants to continue expanding our space-based activities, our system is going to need a bit of an upgrade. And what sounds like more of an upgrade than lasers? While the concept of space lasers may evoke visions of spaceship battles and Death Stars, scientists want to use them to transmit data, not destruction. The lasers we're talking about here are called optical lasers, but most aren't actually using optical or visible light. They're using near-infrared, which is a little bit longer as far as wavelengths go. But they're still way shorter than radio waves, so you can transmit a lot more data per second. Plus, since the whole point of lasers is to create a tightly focused beam of light, an optical space laser signal maintains its strength at greater distances. Scientists have been intermittently testing their space laser tech over the past half century. Back in 1968, as part of the Surveyor 7 mission, they demonstrated that a spacecraft on the moon could detect a laser shining all the way from Earth. Not quite the same as shining a laser pointer near your cat across the room, and probably not as cute, but a very important proof of concept. It took a few decades, but two-way laser communication was eventually tested in the 1990s using the Japanese Space Agency's ETS-6 satellite. And in 2013, NASA used laser light to deliver not just a message, but an image of the Mona Lisa to the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter. But tests beyond the Earth-Moon system are still upcoming. That'll be the job of NASA's upcoming Psyche mission. Currently scheduled to launch in October 2023, the spacecraft will carry the deep space optical communications experiment on its journey to the asteroid Psyche in the belt between Mars and Jupiter. In the meantime, though, you can find plenty of optical space lasers within Earth's orbit. Satellite constellations like Starlink use them so that the satellites can talk amongst each other. As humans continue to push the boundaries of space exploration and venture deeper into the universe, our need for faster and better communication through deep space will continue to grow. One day, space lasers may replace radio entirely. And hey, maybe someone will eventually try using a proper visible laser to send pulses of information from the moon, evoking Goddard's magnesium flashes. And I don't know about you, but I know the first message I'd beam back, it's a little ditty from 1987. Because in my ideal future, Rick Rolls are back in style. Thank you for watching this SciShow video, which was supported by Linode. Linode is a cloud computing company from Akamai that provides access to some of your favorite internet services, from streaming videos to storing files. Right now, as you watch SciShow, you're probably using cloud computing technology. But that doesn't mean you have to be spending all of your money on it. Even without signing up, you can explore Linode's products and solutions or compare prices with other providers. And if you want to make sure that Linode will work for you in a remote area, you can run a speed test by connecting with one of Linode's international facilities, all before any commitment. And if you're curious about costs, you can go to their cloud calculator and simple pricing page so you'll know exactly what you'll be paying for your specific needs. You can see all that Linode has to offer by clicking the link in the description or heading to linode.com/scishow. And that link will give you a $100 60-day credit on a new Linode account. Thanks to Linode for sponsoring this video, and thank you for watching.